since I created this channel and uploaded my first video on the channel. I usually make videos only by myself. Until today, there is a new firearms technology series that appeared on my channel. I think this is also a very significant and historical series video in my channel history, because this is my first time working together to make videos. Alright, without further ado, please allow me welcome to my friend to talk about this firearm tech story. Meanwhile, this will be a long story, so this is episode 1.
When writing stories about gunpowder warfare, especially the early modern warfare, I always wonder how ancient people improved the early small arms rate of fire. While the early breech loaders offered a greater rate of fire, there were too many issues that prevent them being the standard issue small arms in most of the military in the world. Said issues include higher cost of time and materials for manufacturing such small arms. And most importantly, the gas leakage. Then I wonder, did the inventor between the 16th to early 19th century try anything to improve the design of the muzzle loaders to increase the rate of fire? The answer is yes. They used an automatic priming box and self-priming system to increase the rate of fire. In this video, we will focus on the development of the self-priming system, as it's the less complex and more economical way of improving the small arms rate of fire in the early modern period. The general features of the self-priming system include the touch hole, breech plug, the cone or finer black powder, and the ramrod. Let's talk about the touch hole first. Even before the invention of Vinlock, as early as 1627, soldiers began to speed up the rate of loading of the matchlock by dropping powder and bullet without any wad into the barrel and hitting the butt on the ground in order to send the charge home without having to use the ramrod. Since the gunpowder at the time was not fine enough, that means the touch hole of the matchlock couldn't adapt such loading technique. After the invention of Vinlock and the cone of finer gunpowder, the soldiers began further shortcut the loading process by shutting their pan after firing, loaded as aforementioned, and found that hitting the butt on the ground would very often send enough powder through the touch hole prime the pan from the charge in the barrel. Since then, some soldiers had tried to increase the rate of fire by simply enlarging the diameter of the touch hole, like the figure shows. However, such a straight-in touch hole could blow away a large sum of gunpowder when the powder was ignited. Therefore, the inventors started looking for other solutions to improve the touch hole of the muskets. Then, in 1702, Godfrey Hauge invented the conical touch hole for muzzle-loading guns, whereby the pan closed itself, cutting loading time by two-thirds. However, the original drawings of his conical touch hole was lost in time, so I draw the structure of his touch hole based on the scattered clues. Note that the design did not include the specially designed breech plug, which I will go through in another part of the article. You might think that shutting the musket's priming pan after firing, loaded as aforementioned, and hit the butt on the ground would not affect the performance of the muskets. But that's not the case. The result for such practice was that velocity, range, and penetration suffered severely for the last bullet. Not only that, such practice could not sustain the rate of fire once the barrel and the touch hole were full of fouling after a few shots. Next, we'll talk about the designs of the breech plug. In the 18th century, the weapon designers began exploring ways to make the combustion of the main powder charge more efficient, producing more gas pressure in the ball per powder charge. Soon, many patent breech plugs appeared in the market. During the development of breech plugs, some people noticed that breech plugs with grooves or conical breech plugs could guide some powders into the priming pan. So they start researching designs that could work well with the enlarged touch hole to simplify the loading process of muzzle loaders. Let's talk about the cone or finer black powder here. Before the improvement of gunpowder production methods, gunpowder was flour-like, which is hard for loading in the barrel. When people discovered that finer gunpowder could generate greater power, they also found out that such powder could easily flow out of the touch hole. The gunsmiths who were developing the self-priming musket system began researching the best formula of black powder in order to make the system work more fluently. In this clip, the shooter demonstrated that even the touch hole of normal size can easily achieve self-priming if the muzzle loader is using a much finer powder. Finally, we will talk about the evolution of ramrod in the self-priming technology. Most people in modern times overlook the impact of ramrod designs on the musket's rate of fire, believing that the ramrods could deter their reloading speed. Well, it's the exact opposite. The above perception might come from the early design of the ramrod. When using the wooden ramrod, shooters at the time tend to be more careful to avoid breaking it inside the barrel, thus slowing down the reloading speed. With such perception, the German and Dutch machinists began loading their muskets without using their ramrods. That practice also affected the French army in the American Revolutionary War. During the American Revolutionary War, the French had been enlarging the touch holes of their muskets and adding breech plugs with slant face in order to make more certain of priming from the charge and bang their butts on the ground. Of course, due to the fouling of the barrels and the touch holes, such a method couldn't sustain the power for long. The Prussians, on the other hand, saw the importance of using ramrod with better material to increase the rate of fire. As early as 1718, the entire Prussian infantry units were equipped with iron ramrod, and they even practiced reloading with the bayonets fixed. Not only were the iron ramrods more durable than the wooden ramrods, it could even ensure that the balls could still be loaded inside the barrel with serious fouling. In order to avoid turning the ramrod twice in the reloading process, the Prussian officer Freytag introduced the double-head ramrod in 1773. Soon, the Austrians and other Germanic states followed suit. The design proved to be useful as the Austrians retained the double-head iron ramrod in their M1798 musket, which used the traditional touch hole design. With the aforementioned technological development, it's only a matter of time before some practical self-priming designs appear in the 18th century and further developed in the 19th century. In the next video, I will talk about the advantages and disadvantages of self-priming muskets and the reasons for adopting the self-priming finlock system by different countries like Prussia and other Germanic states, northern kingdoms like Sweden, Denmark, Norway, and even the Austria. Afterwards, we will talk about the development of various self-priming systems in different radios. Hope you enjoyed the show, and see you next time.